We all know Texas Instruments, or TI, as the calculator company. Their TI-84 calculators are found in every high school and college in America. Yet, they are secretly one of the world's most successful companies. They currently sit at rank 56 on the S&P 500, almost in the top 10%. How is a calculator company doing so well? Well, as it turns out, their history dates back far beyond calculators. They created possibly the most important invention in history, even more important than the silicon transistor. This is the untold story of Texas Instruments. May 10th, 1954, a conference for the Institute of Radio Engineers is underway, and various scientists and engineers are giving talks. In the front row sits Gordon Teal, a Texas Instruments engineer, and there's a common theme among the talks. They all complain about germanium transistors. Transistors are the foundation of computers and act as switches to control an electrical current. The standard at this point was germanium, great for electrical currents, but with a major downside, they consistently failed at high temperatures. The obvious solution was to use the element right above it on the periodic table, silicon. It was more stable in extreme heat and more abundant, but this also came with its own challenges. Refining the silicon for the transistors required advanced manufacturing techniques that simply didn't exist. As the other engineers complain at the conference, Gordon sits with a wide smile on his face as he fiddles with something in his pocket. The current speaker remarks that no one should expect a silicon transistor for years. With a smug expression, Gordon stands up to give his talk. The audience murmurs and he begins to speak. Contrary to what my colleagues have told you about the bleak prospects for silicon transistors, I happen to have a few of them here in my pocket. The jaws of every audience member collectively drops. This was Texas Instruments' breakout moment. As a small electronic startup, they had solved the biggest problem plaguing the chip industry and were propelled into a leading technology player. What's fascinating is that they weren't even the first. Bell Laboratories had technically beat them by a couple of months and produced the very first workable silicon transistor. Yet, there was a key difference. Bell was a research lab in a complacent telecom giant, AT&T. Texas Instruments, however, not only solved the problem, but they were positioned to manufacture it in a few short months. Basically overnight, Texas Instruments aggressively invested in mass production, and soon they were producing silicon semiconductors for the entire world. Yet, Texas Instruments was facing another huge problem, and there was much more at stake. Computers had stagnated and couldn't increase in power because of how many components were needed, and each of those needed to be wired to other components which each served a single function. This was called the tyranny of numbers. Computers were a mess of cables upon cables, some spanning 50 miles of wiring. The silicon transistor was just one race. The tyranny of numbers was the real marathon for the industry. This problem was halting the progress of computers and things had reached a dead end. Texas Instruments was trying their best, but the odds were stacked against them. Like the silicon transistor, they were competing against other giants like Bell Labs, Fairchild Semiconductor, RCA, General Electric, and many more. Giants who had basically infinite funding. Whoever could solve this impossible problem would not only make billions, but dictate the future of computers and technology itself. Whoever won this race could rule the technology world. Texas Instruments was by no means the favorite in this marathon, but one engineer was about to change that for decades to come. Jack Kilby found himself at Texas Instruments in 1958. He had just graduated with a master's in electrical engineering from the University of Milwaukee, Wisconsin. Kilby had an unhealthy fascination with electronics, specifically making electronics smaller and smaller to make products better like hearing aids or radios. TI was the only company that agreed to let me work on electronic component miniaturization more or less full time, and it turned out to be a great fit. Joining Texas Instruments came with a downside though. As a new employee, he didn't have the right to a summer vacation, which basically all of his colleagues took, so he'd have to work on the tough job alone for some time. But this would actually turn out to be a blessing in disguise. Kilby spent the summer dabbling in the problem everyone else was struggling with, the tyranny of numbers. Before long, a realization dawned on him. What if instead of connecting separate components connected with miles of cable, the components were all built into a single flat piece of semiconductor material? It would get rid of the vast amount of wires and shrink the size of the circuit dramatically. With that, Kilby quickly got to work. In a matter of weeks, Kilby had a prototype and he called a meeting with the company's management. On September 12, 1958, he presented his findings. He showed them a piece of germanium connected to an electrical testing unit. Kilby pressed a switch, and management watched in awe as the screen showed a smooth, repeating wave. The germanium was functioning as a complete circuit, with all the components working together. Kilby had solved the world of computing's greatest problem. He had just created what we now know as the integrated circuit. A celebration erupted within Texas Instruments. They had just made another colossal breakthrough, just a few years after commercializing the silicon transistor. Everyone congratulated Kilby and quickly began moving to capitalize on his discovery. A patent was filed soon after, in February of 1959. US Patent 3138743 for miniaturized electronic circuits, the very first integrated circuit. This invention was about to change the world. All computing devices and electronics as we know them today directly rely on this invention. But Kilby and Texas Instruments were about to encounter another roadblock. Little did they know, they were about to go to war. Unknown to Kilby or Texas Instruments, a rival company in California was also making a breakthrough. But not just any engineer, the engineer Robert Noyce. Known as the mayor of Silicon Valley, Noyce was a co-founder of Fairchild Semiconductor. He would also go on to form Intel in the following years. He was the opposite of Jack Kilby, not introverted, but a charismatic, famous leader in Silicon Valley. As Kilby was celebrating his breakthrough, Noyce was also hell-bent on solving the tyranny of numbers, and had independently come to the same hypothesis, putting multiple components on a single piece of semiconductor. Soon, he had also created an integrated circuit prototype. Two geniuses had reached the same conclusion in a matter of months, but there was one crucial difference that stacked the odds against Texas Instruments. In the race for the silicon transistor, Texas Instruments won, not by being first, but by being better. They were in a better position to mass produce them. Yet, they had fallen into this very same trap just a few years later. The industry was still commonly using germanium for transistors, which is also what Kilby used for his integrated circuit. Noyce, on the other hand, used silicon instead, knowing it was more stable at higher heat and was the future of the industry. It was also a monolithic integrated circuit. Kilby set some wires and thus couldn't be mass-produced at the scale of Noyce's creation. On July 30th, 1959, Noyce filed for a patent for his creation, which was approved and granted within 2 years. But things aren't so simple. Texas Instruments also had a patent for the integrated circuit. Fairchild and them both believed they had solved the problem and had the right to capitalize on it. Thus began the patent war. For the next several years, both companies battled in court. The prize was the future of computing itself. Texas Instruments was first, but Noyce's invention was better. Eventually, they came to an agreement, but it wasn't in TI's favor. They could produce and manufacture the integrated circuit, but had to make license payments to Fairchild. This would obviously hurt TI's profits, and to make matters worse, the courts eventually sided with Fairchild as the rightful owner of the monolithic integrated circuit. Moreover, the years of legal fees had diverted huge resources away from more research and innovation. Employee morale at Texas Instruments was at an all-time low. They needed to bounce back, but how? Several years later, Texas Instruments is still alive, producing microchips for the industrial and military sectors. But they needed something new. They needed another breakthrough to propel them forward. The company president, Pat Haggerty, believed this would come from consumer products instead of industrial. Something that used their existing chips that they could mass produce. Haggerty entrusted this task to Kilby and a small group of associates. Kilby and his team began evaluating their options, and soon the team settled on a single idea. But Texas Instruments, after this thing of the integrated circuit, made sure to keep this close to their chest. It was a top secret project codenamed Project Caltech. The team worked on a small electronic device, which included a keyboard, a screen, a portable power supply, and a central processor. In September 1967, Kilby and his team applied for a patent after several revisions and received US patent number 3819921, the portable calculator. All calculators at this point were gigantic and were only available for big businesses and the government. This one was the size of a book. The first product was the TI-2500, and despite being $120 each, or $1,100 today, demand was through the roof. In just 1 year, 17 million units were sold. Just 2 years later, that number had jumped to 45 million. Kilby might have missed the success of the integrated circuit, but his work led to the creation of the handheld calculator, an invention that transformed the future of education, science, and mathematics. This put TI back in the game, and soon they began picking up momentum. While producing calculators with a new influx of revenue, the company leaned back into the semiconductor industry that they helped create, only this time they had a different focus. Their rivals, like Fairchild as well as the recently formed Intel, were producing digital chips for computing, fast, complicated chips like CPUs. TI decided to focus on less flashy semiconductors that were equally important, analog chips. These process information like light, sound, or pressure, and were used for machines in factories, medicine, aerospace, and automotives. It was a quiet, genius move that allowed them to thrive for decades. The demand might have been high in computing, but it had a lot of ups and downs. Analog, on the other hand, was stable and there was always demand. They were in the perfect position for long-term success in all kinds of industries. For example, when EV started booming, it wasn't just Nvidia who was positioned perfectly, but also Texas Instruments. Same with self-driving cars, robots, and medical equipment. Analog has allowed Texas Instruments to thrive far into the future. In fact, in their 2023 investor report, Analog accounted for 74% of the revenue at over $13 billion. The story of Texas Instruments shows one truth: being first isn't what matters. What matters is being the best. The truth allowed them to win, but it also hit them hard with the integrated circuit. But the important thing is that they rebounded to set themselves up for the future. Despite losing to Fairchild, it's TI that's still around. Fairchild split into several companies, including both Intel and AMD, which are huge companies, but they don't carry the Fairchild name. So TI technically got the last laugh, as they're still a strong, independently traded company. Even though they couldn't capitalize on the integrated circuit, it was a huge milestone for computing, and Jack Kilby got his recognition. Both Kilby and Noyce were recognized as equal co-founders, and he was awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics in 2000. And that is the untold story of the calculator company that actually changed the world. If you would like to see more questions logically answered, comment that down below. But until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.